I hope that this is a moment of enlightenment.
Welcome back, everyone. Now to an ABC News report on the recent rise of gun purchases by Black, Asian, and Hispanic Americans. It's part of ABC's digital series, Rethinking Gun Violence, an examination of the level of gun violence in the U.S. and what can be done about it. We take a look by the numbers. 58%, that's how much gun ownership has increased among Black Americans from 2019 to 2020, according to the National Shooting Sports Foundation. It also found a 49% increase among Hispanic Americans that same year, and a 43% increase among Asian Americans. The group estimates that about 40% of 2020 gun sales were made to first-time gun buyers. Now, one explanation for that is that in 2020, according to the FBI, hate crimes reached the highest number in more than a decade. 10 years it had not been that high. ABC News spoke to a number of new gun owners who say that they feel a more urgent need to protect themselves. Still, white men are the most likely to own a gun, according to Pew. About 50% say they do. That's compared to about 25% of white women and non-white men who are gun owners, and 16% of non-white women who own a firearm.
Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.
Welcome to another installment of the Connecticut Gun Bench. Today's video is brought to you by P.A.N. Firearms, LLC. P.A.N. Firearms for NRA certification and multifaceted gun training. You can reach us at 203-300-6343 or use our website at www.panfirearmsllc.com. As always, there'll be a link in the description box below. But let's talk about this. With the last couple of years, with the advent also of COVID, there's been a massive increase in gun ownership, and especially first-time gun owners. And the biggest group, or the largest jump percentage-wise, has been among Black or so-called African-Americans. The biggest demographic within that has been Black women. I think it's an interesting phenomenon, and I needed to speak about it because I've been saying this for probably a good 5 to 10 years plus, that gun control, when they make gun control laws, they tend to hurt the minority communities more than any other. But there's an article here from the Patriot America US titled, Black Firearms Owners, Gun Control Hurts Our Communities. Jessica Luckett got her first gun at the height of the COVID-19 pandemic, and it opened her eyes to the various laws and policies governing legal firearms ownership. She works remotely for a nonprofit and lives alone in a West Pullman townhouse in the southern tip of Chicago. She often visits family and friends in Englewood, a high-crime neighborhood on the south side where she grew up. For Illinois residents to own a gun, they must get a firearm owner's identification card, which is a month-long process. Then to carry the gun outside of the home for self-defense, a concealed carry license is needed, which Luckett acquired. Yet, through friends at a women's gun club, she learned that other states observe very different gun laws. Most don't ask for a firearms owner identification card, and some don't even ask for a concealed carry license. Why do we have an amendment that says right to bear arms, yet all states are so different, she asked. The amendment is for the entire United States. It is not for one state or another. Jessica Luckett holds training ammunition at her home in Chicago on February 23rd, 2022. She uses them to practice at a local gun range. She also questions the push for various gun control measures at the federal, state, and local levels, often by lawmakers from her party, the Democrats. It has taken away our Second Amendment right to bear arms, and I believe we should be able to protect ourselves, she said. Like Luckett, many first-time Black gun owners are on a similar discovery journey, looking more closely at the narrative and policies affecting their newly embraced Second Amendment rights, according to Philip Smith, president of the National African American Guns Association. During the pandemic era, gun sales boomed. 21 million sales-related background checks were conducted in 2020, according to an estimate by Firearms Industry and Trade Association. African Americans and first-time gun buyers were the groups that registered the biggest jumps. People line up to buy guns and ammunition at the Ready Gunner gun store in Orem, Utah on January 10, 2021. The wave of new gun ownership slowed in 2021, but still appeared to be stronger than pre-pandemic levels. The rising tide is felt at Smith's organization, which adds about 800 new members every month, he said. The total membership stands at around 45,000. Millions of black folks who never bought a gun now have a gun, and they start to question the narratives about guns they heard previously, Smith said. When they go to have a conversation with their local officials, even if they are voting Democratic, if that official says something negative about guns, they will say, hold on, I'm a gun owner too, and I am not a bad person. So what do you mean by that, he said. His group has opened the door to black gun owners of all party affiliations, whether Democrat, Republican, Libertarian, or Independent. What I care about is that you are a black person and that you want to get trained and protect yourself, your family, and your community. That's all I care about, he said. Quite a few politicians sought his endorsements, but he flatly refused. The association stays away from politics and focuses only on policies affecting Second Amendment rights, Smith said. But there's a problem there. I'm going to stop for a minute because I have to say this. He focuses on policies affecting Second Amendment rights, but who are the people or the party that pushes the most for anti-Second Amendment laws and policies? Well, it's the party that he seems to align himself with. One such example is red flag laws, which Smith opposes. He said, in theory, the proposal sounds good, great, taking guns out of the hands of dangerous people, but in practice, it has the potential to cast a wide net and deprive law-abiding citizens of the right to bear arms, he said. Historically, strict gun laws in major cities such as Chicago hinder black people from owning firearms for self-defense, according to David Hayes, vice president of the Chicago-based 761st Gun Club. As a boy, he spent many years in Mississippi, where almost every household owned guns. At 18, he moved to Chicago's South Side and was shocked to find the only people who had guns were criminals or police officers. A woman holds a small flag depicting bloody bullet holes during an anti-gun violence march on the Magnificent Mile in Chicago on December 31st, 2020. Later, he read, to find out why, he found that the city had tightened gun control during the tumultuous 1960s under Mayor Richard Daley and went further during the crime wave in the 1980s under Mayor James Byrne, who steered through an ordinance to ban handguns, including the affordable .38 Special Revolver. While the handgun ban was ruled unconstitutional by the U.S. Supreme Court, and that was McDonald versus Chicago, by the U.S. Supreme Court and eliminated in 2010, its former existence has drilled into the minds of many inner city blacks that it was illegal to own a gun, Hayes says. That includes Hayes' mother-in-law who lived in Chicago and had long thought it was illegal to own a gun, a mindset she carried with her even after moving out of the city and passed that down to her daughter, Sierra Hayes. Sierra Hayes holds her first gun, on her living room couch in Richland Park, Illinois. Growing up in a middle-class suburb, Sierra Hayes never wanted to have anything to do with a gun. Aside from her mother's influence, she said she also was influenced by the constant association of guns with black criminals in the media and on television. Subconsciously, I long had this notion that a black person with a gun was a criminal and a white person with a gun was a patriot. It took years of rational conversation between Sierra and David Hayes for her to break from that mentality. She said in 2020, she bought her first gun. Now the Hayeses teach their three children about Second Amendment and gun safety. Sierra Hayes also brought her family, including her mother, to a shooting event. David Hayes teaches his six-year-old son how to safely hold a training gun in a living room in Richland Park, Illinois on March 31st, 2021. Hayes often travels from his suburban home to the South Side to host free community classes on gun safety and responsible gun ownership. Quote, today's politicians in Chicago continue to use gang violence as a cloak to push for more and more gun control. A lot of times, black people don't compare the laws to the actual crimes, and they don't see that most of the guns used in gang violence are illegally acquired, Hayes says. These policies will not stop the gang violence. They only hurt the legal gun owners. Now, the pro-gun association or pro-gun part of America has been saying that for years. Gun control laws don't stop the criminals from being criminals. They only hurt, you know, the law abiding. We've been saying that for so long, you could literally make a quote out of that. But I read all this because I find it now interesting that black people are catching on. That when these Democrats make these anti-gun laws, they don't affect the criminal element. They only affect them, and they're starting to speak up and stand up. Now, the underlying problem is, now that their eyes have been opened to what's actually going on as far as gun ownership and the use of firearms, are they going to keep voting for the same people, which are mostly Democrat, when they see that these same people are the ones who inherently just deprive them of their right to self-defense? Especially Chicago. We know what goes on in Chicago. We see the news every Monday morning. Over the weekend, you know, tens of people get shot, and some of their fatalities, and it's so damn unfortunate. But will this change their mind and who they vote for? Now, it would behoove us as the pro-gun persons within this in the United States to start to bring these people into our fold, because that just strengthens, not only, well, mostly it'll strengthen our rights, but it will also strengthen our voting base. I've said this time and time again, the Democrats have been playing the black community for fools for decades. I know most people don't like that, but it's the truth. Look what happened with this last election. Biden came out here and made all these promises to the black community and has not kept one of them. As a matter of fact, he defunded the HBCU, which is historically black college and university funding, and was going to, you know, basically give up like hundreds of thousands of dollars to illegals that were separated at the border. That doesn't sound very pro-black to me. But this is a great thing that is happening. Now, remember I said before, 66%, which is the biggest jump percentage-wise in the demographic, was black women became first-time gun owners. And I'm hoping that becoming gun owners and then realizing, well, I'm a good person, why do I have to now adhere to laws that don't really stop the criminals, that is only hindering me from doing what I can do constitutionally? So, and you know, obviously you know that I'm black. I've been a gun owner since 1989, I bought my first gun. It was a Sig P220. And I actually bought it for protection. It's another story, and I'm not going to get into it, but I really felt the need to go purchase a gun because I felt very uncomfortable with the situation that had unfortunately developed when I was on jury duty. So, like I said before, this is a great thing. I saw this story, and I just had to comment on it, that I'm hoping that people will step up. And we need to bury all the little nuances amongst us as ethnicities and start focusing on each other as Americans. We're too quick to divide ourselves into little groups and then adhere to whatever the ideology of that group is. This is a constitutional right for all of us. And you have to remember, and this is historically true, unofficially, the first gun control laws were based on racism. I did a video about that where I talked about what they call black code laws in the South. When the, you know, the U.S. government said that the Second Amendment applies to everyone, states in the South would go ahead and they would make laws specifically to prevent people of color and immigrants from obtaining firearms. So hopefully this will be a turning point, because here in Connecticut, we had a massive boost of so-called people of color who became first-time gun owners. And a lot of them, when back in March 14th, when the governor's bill number 16 came into play, there were a lot of people outside of what traditionally would be the gun pro-gun group who came out and spoke out against it. And I think that was key, absolutely key, to the governor's bill being gutted from 52 pages to 3. But we will watch this and see how this goes. I mean, we do have a midterm coming up. But I hope that these people are enlightened and they realize that the Democrats really aren't looking out for their best interests. They really aren't. But let me know what you think. As always, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. As always, any statements of violence or statements that lead to violence will be removed. Please like, share, and subscribe. Hit the notification bell to let me know, you know, let notify you when the next video goes live. And I will see you on the next one. Peace.